Hello, and welcome to Coach TV. On this series, the best and brightest business and executive coaches and specialized consultants share their views and their tactics to enable peak performance and better business. Today, we have some very interesting guests with us. To start with, we have Andrea Nierenberg of the Nierenberg Group.
Great to be here.
Glad to have you. Jaime Marco, Evolve the Business.
Ready to have a wow experience with you, Bruce.
Absolutely. And finally, Joan Lowery from Lowery Communications.
Good morning, Bruce.
Good morning, all of you. So, Andrea, let me start with you.
Okay.
I understand that you're referred to as the networking guru.
Well, why
is that?
Well, I think what it is, I always say that the opposite of networking is not working. That every time you meet someone, you can learn from that person, be a resource, give something, and help them. So if we think about that, it's not just for work, it's life. It's really a state of mind. There is a structure and process when I talk about the seven types of networking. However, if we think of it as a curiosity, so I try to execute the skills and put it in part of my DNA and my brand.
The seven types of networking, what are those?
Oh, they're a variety. So if you go to an event, structured and strategic is one.
Okay.
Most of life, though, is serendipitous, anywhere, mm-hmm. anytime, any place where we meet people. Okay. The third is strategic introductions, so which is what we want when somebody else blows our own horn to somebody else and talks about our value.
Okay.
We also have social media, which again is another whole part of networking, if we will. Mm-hmm. Then we have social encounters, so charities or social or different types of groups and organizations that you belong to,
right.
where you can form a niche to develop targeted networking. And then also your style, because one size does not fit all.
Okay. What would be the three most important tactics in networking?
Well, the ones that I like to talk about specifically are listen and learn. Every time you meet somebody, if you really listen, we hear, but we don't always listen. There's a reason we were given two ears and one mouth to use in proportion. So when we really listen, we learn, which is also the word ear in the word learn. And I have a list of 34 things that you learn about people over time. But when you really listen to somebody, you can ask them the three most important words. Tell me more. So people will tell you about themselves. And the more things that they tell you and you learn and you remember and you write it down, because no matter how sharp your mind is, it's still weaker than the palest ink.
Sure.
People write it down, so you have that. And then you can refer back to things that you want to talk about more. Second one is create synergies and make connections with other people. So I always will ask somebody, how do I know if I'm speaking to somebody that perhaps could use your product or service? Or who would you like to meet? I may not know that person, but at least I might start to formulate. But by asking that question, I learn a little bit more. And when you do create connections with people, mm-hmm. 1 + 1 = 3, because they'll remember you down the road. And the third one is to follow up. After all is said and done, much more is said than done. So if people actually follow up and you under-promise, over-deliver. And another thing that I always ask somebody is, what's your preferred method of communication? Because we have a lot of different vehicles to get to a face-to-face again. We could email, we could call, we could text, we could use social media, variety.
So I have a little confession to make.
Okay.
For many years, I owned a networking company
mm-hmm.
where we put people together. And yet, for myself, if I walk into a room where I don't know people and it's a networking environment, I'm shy, I'm freezing, I don't feel comfortable doing that. How do you help people in that situation?
Exactly, because many of us, no matter how extroverted or whether we're introverted or ambiverts or confident, no matter what, we all have that kind of feeling like frozen in the doorway. So I have a list, a checklist, which I say what you do before, during, and after an event. However, what I also like to tell people that say I'm really shy is create what I call the post. So plan your action according to your personality.
Okay.
O is do it in an organized fashion, so you've set your goals, and ask people open-ended, high-gain questions like, tell me more. And then S, stick to your system, because my system may not work for somebody else. And also remember, when you go into any kind of event or anywhere in life, smile. You know, people sometimes think if they go to that activity of mm-hmm. networking,
right.
that they're going to the guillotine. So they go in like, you know, with their face down and downtrodden. But go in approachable, confident. You've already got your goal in mind.
Right.
And then T is know that it takes time to develop relationships. So take the time and trust yourself. And also follow my 2-2-2 principle, which is go to 2 meetings, meet 2 people, and have 2 follow-ups.
How did you become this expert in this area? What was your path?
You know, I think what it was, something my father told me before when I was going to camp.
Okay.
You know, and I was very shy. It's just, you know, he always said, just make friends, take the initiative, say hello to people, and listen. And then one thing started, you know, I just sort of kept following those principles. And he also told me, give without remembering, receive without forgetting. So just give. And through business, when I was in the magazine business, I just started following these principles. And the word networking really wasn't even around in those days.
It's true. It's true. I'm going to have a few more questions for you a little bit later on. But in the meantime, can you tell us how can people reach you?
Yes, I answer to all forms of communication. So my website is nierenberggroup.com. However, email, phone, text, and social media.
Okay.
Thank
Thanks
you.
Very much.
Thank you.
We'll be back to you. Okay. Jaime.
Yes.
I know you as a customer services expert.
Absolutely.
Okay. So let me just give you something that happened to me just the other day.
Sure.
You can tell me what you think about it.
Okay.
So I went to one of these chain stores where you buy a pastry and coffee, and I won't mention the name. And no, it wasn't Starbucks. And the person was greeted me with kind of a grimace, like it was not a good person to be around. And then the service was extremely slow and wrong. I got the wrong thing. And then finally, the person didn't know how to make change. Okay. Now that sounds to me like somebody who could use a little bit of training. Is that the kind of situation that you would be able to help?
Exactly, it definitely is. You know, I'm sad to hear that you had that experience, but unfortunately that is very common in today's day and age. You know, when I talk to clients or I talk to people and I say, when was the last time you had a great experience? They can't remember it, but I hear so many stories just like yours that, I mean, beyond every day I hear a story about how they had bad service. We went to dinner just last night and had horrific service, and it happens all the time.
Right.
And a good friend once told me, you have 2 choices. You can be furious, which you probably were, or be curious and find out why that's happening, what's happening there. And it's my bet here that there's probably not adequate training for that group there, and there's definitely not people reinforcing what they expect from their team as well too. So checking in and inspecting what they're expecting. So our training does help with that.
Okay, so give us a few experiences that you've had in training and what you've been able to accomplish with some of your clients.
Sure. So, for example, so I did a talk a few weeks ago, and it had a bunch of different industries in the room, and we were talking about customer service versus customer experience. And most people call it customer service. And I said, let's get that word service out of our minds, because really what we want to do is create an experience for people. And so as soon as I said that word, I automatically saw light bulbs go off in the audience. And I said, oh, experience. Because so many people, like the girl that you encountered, the man, whoever it was, you didn't say, but the person that you encountered at the coffee shop, they thought you ordered a coffee, you ordered a pastry, and they served you. They felt that they did their job. They got you what you needed. That is service. But what they don't realize is that your experience, that you were going to go on a show a few weeks later or a day later and say about that bad experience. And so once we start to change the mindset of people and they start to recognize that it's not just about giving somebody something that they need because they're there to purchase it, but it's about creating an experience for them, then that's when mindsets start to change. And I saw that at the talk that I gave. And everyone from doctor's offices to attorneys to internet marketers, they were like, oh, I never thought of it as the overall experience. So that's the first step of how we start to change their mindset.
So your mission, it sounds like, is to reduce people's bad experiences.
It is, and in fact, we started a new program called the STAR program, and it's called Someone to Award and Recognize.
Right.
So as a business, we have mystery shoppers that go out and shop different businesses to show them what their customer experience is like, because they don't always know. They could have a corporate office in Nashville and have an office here and not know what's happening in their store. So we do mystery shopping. Well, I'm always looking to catch people doing more things right rather than less things wrong.
Okay.
So I started a program called the STAR program, Someone to Award and Recognize. And what that is that I've got shoppers in the community that when they go out and they encounter a true 5-star experience, that person gets a nice little placard that says you've been caught doing something great. and they get a bracelet that says, I'm a star. We take a picture of them, we put it on social media, and we spread the word about that great experience. You know what they say about news, right? You know that old adage about news? Good news travels, bad news travels fast. I want to change that. I want to start highlighting and rewarding those people that are doing something great.
That's a great idea.
Well, thanks. Yeah.
I've not seen anybody do that before.
Well, thanks.
Okay. I also understand that you're a business coach and also a sales trainer.
That is correct.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. So my goal really as a business consultant and coach is to come into a business that knows they need to change something. They say, you know what, it's just not working. We're just not happy, or we're not getting the results that we want, or we're just not seeing the movement or the metrics happen that we need, or the behaviors on our team. So as a coach, the first thing I do is I come in and I sit with a business and we talk about an overall 360 view of their business. Everything from marketing to training to finance, everything. And I do a whole analysis and I say, listen, this is my view of your business. This is the areas that I think you should focus on, whether that's training, sales training, customer experience, leadership development, whether that's branding and marketing, social media presence, whatever that looks like. And I give them an idea and I say, this is where we should start. And that's where the training comes into. So if they need sales training, it's sales training. If they need brand marketing, it's brand marketing. My first step is to really come in, understand, immerse myself in their business, understand what their needs are, and help them fulfill those.
Okay. So going back to customer service for a minute.
Sure. Experience. See, it's a mindset.
There you go. Yes.
Changing one person at a time.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Exactly. So what are the three biggest mistakes that companies make when it comes to customer service?
It's a great question. So the first one would be is that they focus on the metrics, not on the behaviors. That is huge. So metrics, yes, everyone wants to make more money, right? That's what we're all in it for. We want to make more money. We want to be there. But a lot of times what you're driving the metrics to do aren't really addressing the behaviors that create that great experience. So that's the first step, the first mistake. The second mistake is that they don't invest in their people. So a lot of times in some of these stores that could be, you know, I did a training for a pool company not too long ago. They have two people that are working in their store. That's it. But they are the first face that someone sees when they walk into that business. Sure. And I worked with them on creating a new experience. They invested in their people to do that. A lot of companies don't do that because they say, oh, my team's not big enough, I have one person. Well, if that one person is your frontline defense and they're not doing a great job, then you're losing money all day long, every day.
Sure.
And the third step or the third mistake that they miss out on is asking for help. It's okay to ask for help. It doesn't mean that you're failing as a business. It doesn't mean that you're doing something wrong. It just means that you recognize there's an area to improve. I always ask everyone I talk to, how many of us think we can get better each day? And everyone should raise their hand. I believe it as well, too. I'm always furthering my education. If you don't believe that, we teach a humility class on Fridays.
How is Evolve different from other companies that do what you do?
Yeah. So it's one thing to, you know, have a million degrees as a trainer, or have a certificate on the wall, whatever it is. But the difference is with Evolve is that we truly immerse ourselves in our clients. So the first step when we meet with a client is a shadow day. We won't even take on a training client or a marketing client or a leadership client, anything, without going in and sitting with their people or sitting with their team for a little bit of time before we even talk about what the next steps are. So that's a big step, is that, and that's complimentary. We come in and we just want to meet with your team to shadow and see what's going on there. Okay. The next thing that makes us different is that I truly, and I hope it's coming out here, I love what I do. I am truly passionate about helping people. And I love what Andrea said about how networking is not just about business, it's about life. And she is this type of person as well, too, is about just truly caring about people and wanting to help people. Right. One of the greatest mantras I came across years ago was humankind, be both. And that is what I live at every day first. That's the first thing that I live about first. I just want to help. It's not about the money. I honestly, like, if I won the lottery and millions of dollars, I would still be doing what I do because I love to help businesses. And that's what I find to be different about some other opportunities that you might come across.
Sure. One of the things that consultants, coaches always deal with is that you can sell into a department or a subsidiary and they really want you to provide that service.
Sure.
And then the proposal goes to the CFO.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. The CFO looks at it and says, what's the return on investment?
Sure. Okay.
How do you answer that question?
Right. So the ROI, right? The return on the investment. I get that question all of the time.
Sure.
Most recently, I had a client that was asking that as well, too. And so one of the things when it comes to training, and there's different pieces, so 25% of what I do is a brand marketing position. And that's where I'm helping businesses develop their brand online, helping them post and do social media. And so that's easy to measure, right? You can see that in the metrics. There's actual metrics through social media tools that show you that. But when it comes to the training, leadership, sales, customer experience, everyone's like, well, what's the ROI? How do I see that? That's why we take on a minimum engagement typically of 6 months, because it takes a minimum of 6 months to start to change behaviors. And when you're looking for ROI, you look at the metrics. But those metrics can't change until the behaviors change. And on top of that, those behaviors won't really change after a one and done training. Okay. There has to be follow-up coaching. There has to be accountability in place for that CFO holding the team accountable to using the process.
Sure.
So I work with my teams and I work with my clients and I say, listen, we're not just going to leave you. We want you to see the metrics that you're looking for. And if we don't deliver, we'll give you your money back. Guaranteed. I'll give money back. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't see that change and we hold you accountable, we do all the steps that we talk about that we break down when we meet our initial agreement. Right. If you follow all these steps, you're going to see your metrics change. Okay.
What are the kinds of companies that really need customer service training?
Everyone, your coffee shop, right?
Yes.
But really everybody. I talked about the pool company that I worked with. I've got doctor's offices that I work with. I have home security companies, lawyers, realtors, anyone who interacts with another human being, even internally. So I've done some work with some of the municipalities about working internally with their internal customers, employees. Okay. They don't know how to communicate with each other. And if you're in a frustrated work environment, how are you going to treat the customer that's external?
Right.
Not so great, right?
Right.
So anyone that interacts with people should have customer experience training.
What's the one piece of advice that you would give to a company when it relates to customer service?
Yeah. Invest in your people. You have to invest in your people. You know, it's something every company's different, but on average, it's about $460 just to hire somebody, from marketing, bringing them on, all of that. And when you hire somebody on, you don't give them the tools and the training and the understanding and the skills they need to grow and develop and be a brand ambassador for your business, then that $460 is nothing, because you're losing so much more money on the back end when somebody walks into your coffee shop and they have the experience like you did.
Okay. So I imagine that you provide services all over the country.
I do.
So how do people reach Evolve the Business?
Sure, that's a great question. And so it's super easy. You can go to our website, evolvethebusiness.com. Okay. And once you go there, you'll see access to our social media, to our email, phone number, whatever you need. So you choose. We've got teams available here to help you whenever you're ready.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Last but not least, Joan Lowery. Joan Lowery from Lowery Communications. Joan, you're known as an expert on media training, among other things. What was your pathway to get to what you're doing now?
It was a circuitous path, and as Andrea talked about, a serendipitous path. Circuitous, but natural. Before I got into that, I have a master's degree in training and did many years of communication skills training before becoming a talk show host, reporter, and producer on radio and television. Okay. So I had the skills, but one day, serendipitously, I was working on a TV health news story for a hospital in the San Francisco Bay Area where I used to live. And I was shooting the breeze with the marketing director, and she mentioned that she had just put together a media training for the spokesperson physicians, and she hired a producer from television, and it was a disaster because this producer didn't know anything about how people learn. Right. So I said to her, you know, I could do that. And she said, well, do it. And I was thrilled that she gave me that chance. So I put my mind together, and I created a program, and I worked with her physicians. I loved it. They loved it. The rest is history. It's really become my specialty.
So explain a little bit about your services and how it works.
Well, what I do in any of the communication skills courses, I'm very big on practice. Rehearsal, practice, behavioral change. And the only way you can do that is practice and role playing.
Okay.
With that said, in media training, we work with small groups of people, and we do intensive video recording of mock role plays of interviews, both with the broadcast, the print, or the social media press. And then there are some core skills that they learn. Number one, they need to learn how to get to the point.
Okay.
Because the broadcast media has a very short attention span, as we all know, 15 seconds or less. So that's a certain skill. It's becoming more headline-driven versus long-winded. The second skill that's very, very important and gives people confidence is how to deal with difficult questions, questions you should not be touching for one reason or another. Rather than change the topic and look sleazy or just ignore it, in which case the reporter has to dig in, it's a technique, we call it bridging, where you let the person know why you can't answer the question, but you try to relate it to something that you can discuss. It could be a trend. It could be something related. 98% of the time, it's something related. And that's an invaluable skill for people, whether it's in television, radio, print, or in life. You're giving a presentation, you get asked a question, and you need to let a person know why you can't go down that path. So that is the second core skill. The third core skill, which a lot of people don't realize, is all of us in our work are filled with jargon. Jargon, it could be in science, it could be in engineering, it could be in physicianing, it could be in anything. And they don't realize that that alienates people because people are too embarrassed to ask what those words mean. So probably the most challenging part of the training is getting people to translate what they use every day that is jargon into easily understandable English. And then finally, with the video and the feedback, it's getting to see what you really do well. Most people don't realize how good they are. And then noticing what you might want to change and working on that. And when I say noticing what you might want to change, it could be visual, vocal, or verbal, your message.
You must have some really great stories to share in terms of some of your clients and what you've done. Can you tell us?
I can share a couple, yeah. Sure. One thing is I do want to say that it's a very fun, entertaining, and hilarious sometimes process of doing training. I don't come in with the big lights like some people get real intimidated. Reporters come in, big lights intimidate them. Okay. We try to support people.
Right.
So a lot of my time is spent on body language and voice tone because people are not aware of that unless they're performers. So the first thing I want to share with you is being in Singapore, doing a media training with an engineering group, and this one guy had his hands under, like locked under his legs like this. He looked like a hostage. He came out after we saw the video and he used his hands well, normally. And I said, what was that about? And he very proudly said, well, when I was getting my MBA, our presentation skills teacher said, don't use your hands. And so rhetorically, I said, really, who would that be? And he said very proudly, we had the former press agent for the Queen of England, which is what the class did. They went hysterical.
Sure.
The second one is another hand story. I spend a lot of time getting people out of the fig leaf, right? Or we notice people have their thumbs going because their thumbs are saying, let me out of here, let me out, unconsciously.
Right.
So we had a physician who, in about the second or third interview, had his hands, he looked like a little dog. He had his little paws up like this.
Right.
And he was talking and using his hands with his paws up here. And when we looked at it later, I said, well, what was that about? And he said, well, I thought if I didn't get them up, I would never use them.
Sure.
So I appreciated that. He was in process. He was actually on the way to using his hands from his lap up to here. And then the third example is the head tilt. A lot of people, when they're listening, go like this, and they're not conscious of it, and it's okay off camera, but on camera, it looks kind of weird. Well, we had one guy who was an executive in an engineering firm, and he had his head tilt even when he was speaking. He was like this, and I worked with him. I struggled with him the whole day with his head tilt, and finally, I had an idea to get his PR person to put his hands on his head and hold his head up. And so he looked kind of like an alien because he had these hands behind his head. But we did it. And the PR person gave feedback about how heavy that head was because that head wanted to go like this. Yeah, 8 pounds. Wanted to go like this and he had to fight it. But these are just examples of how long behavioral patterns set, you know, they set in over a lifetime. And it could be a quick fix or it's something you need to work on day to day.
Sure.
And it's very much like Jaime was saying, you don't just hit and run, you have to keep working on it over and over and over.
Those are great stories.
Thank you.
What is the one thing that you would advise somebody that needed media training? What is the top thing that they should know?
Only one?
Or three. Let's give me three.
Give me three. Give me three, please.
You got three.
The top thing is rehearse. practice, practice, practice. Do not use your interview with the press as your dress rehearsal.
Okay.
Too many experts think they have it up here. What's up here doesn't come out concise, to the point,
yes,
with a good body language and voice tone. Right. So that would be number one. Number two is be audience focused. Prepare statistics, metaphors, analogies, examples that relate to the particular audience that's going to be viewing or reading or seeing you.
Right?
And the third would be learn how to get to the point. Not only for yourself and the audience, but as you know, as a talk show host, you can't just let somebody go on and on and on. So it's learning how to really get to the point.
Okay.
And then you'll get more accomplished.
How do people find you?
Anyway, like the others mentioned, but my website is www.lowery, L-O-W-E-R-Y, communications.com.
Okay, that's great. I wanted to get back. Andrea has a new book. This is book number what now?
Five.
Wow.
Book number five. And it's called Networking, That Really Works. I'm trying to read it sideways. It doesn't work so well. And so tell us a little bit about this book.
Well, the book is a compilation of some of the other books I wrote, and it's putting together all the different areas of relationship marketing, networking, to find, grow, and keep your business, or perhaps move to a new area. Okay. A new surge has been people that are net friending and networking in retirement.
Okay.
So there's all kinds of things. So, and it's got exercises, kind of a mini workbook, so all kind of in one.
Okay, so we highly recommend this book.
Thank you so much, Bruce.
I need to read this.
Oh, I think you know it. Common sense, but not always common practice in that book.
Mm. Okay,
oh, I love
good.
That.
So a couple of further questions for you. We always meet people that do the kinds of things that you do. Okay, you're not the only ones in the world that do this, but you're the best, and that's why you're on this show. How do people really recognize the real deal from the wannabes? Mm-hmm. How do you do that?
Well,
start
I think
with
one
you.
Way is live your brand. Make sure you really deliver, because as we all know, word travels fast. And what you said, bad news travels faster.
Right.
So be authentic, be sincere, deliver, under promise, over deliver, and live your, like I call it, live it in your DNA, your brand.
Okay. What do you think, Jimmy?
You know, it's really important that when you're looking to work with somebody, that you probably have heard this before, work with someone that you know, you like, and you trust. And trust is going to be the big piece on there. So you go back to finding out their references, see who they've worked with before, but really knowing what you want in a facilitator, in a coach, in a consultant, and identifying that, and then meeting with that person and interview a few people.
Absolutely.
You know, I will be the first to admit that I'm not always going to be the right coach for someone. They might need some things that I can't provide for them after we have our discovery session, and I will always point them in the direction of someone that might be better for them. But interview your people and know who you want to work with, but really find someone that you know, you like, and you trust, and then go from there and follow your gut. Really follow your gut. I always believe that your gut tells you a lot more than you think it does.
What is the role of chemistry in that?
It's huge.
You think so, too?
Yeah, absolutely.
Joan?
Yes.
Chemistry
and more. Now, in my world, in the media training world, people confuse media training with media awareness training.
Okay.
And many times people will tell me they've been media trained, and I'll say, did you go on video? How many people are in the class? Was it customized? And most of the time, that's not the case. So I would want to know that it's customized. How many times am I going to get on camera? I would want to ask for references. But I would want to know very specifically, what can I expect from this?
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense. And when it comes to pricing, again, you receive all kinds of prices from coaches. Okay. How do you know what is a reasonable price that a coach should charge you? Do you have a sense of that?
Yes, because a lot of times I'll ask very much about what in the past they, you know, what kind of budget they have, what they've allotted, and then when we go through a lot, like what Jaime was talking about and Joan, the discovery process, and going through all that, you come up with a formulation.
You do,
something.
Okay.
Absolutely. And sometimes you have to sometimes give a little, and you know, things have a way of, especially if it's a long-term project, more comes at the end.
Okay. Jaime, what do you think?
So a big piece with us is that we really customize everything that we do.
Okay.
So when we go in and we do that discovery session, we talk about their needs, what they're looking for. We not only find out what they need, but we also identify goals they want to have at the end of the training. And so we have those goals plastered everywhere as we're going through and working with their teams. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to pricing, there really is not one universal price. It's really about how much time are we investing with your team? What are you looking for? What does it take, or what is it going to need to take to change those behaviors? So everything I do is customized to the client based on their individual needs.
And Joan, we have a few seconds. What do you
Well, there's a little elephant in the room, because depending on where you're working, the pricing is very different.
Right.
I worked in the Bay Area. I still work in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. And my pricing is not the same there as it is in Florida. So you have to be really sensitive to the market and what the market will bear, or you could price yourself right out of the business.
Okay.
So it's a fine line.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Well, you folks have been grand. I really appreciate you coming on. You are the best. And thank you so much.
So
you've given
you.
Some great
so
insights,
you, yeah.
and it's been really fun. Thank you so much.
Thanks very much.
Well, this has been Coach TV. I hope you've enjoyed our program and learned something from these fabulous people. And we will see you again.